Okay, hello. So my name is Mike Ausendorf from Bareus from Germany, and we are here on the cybersecurity track, and this talk is about don't let them take your hostage, be prepared by open source backups when it comes to talk about ransomware and other threats. So we will talk about disaster recovery, not only in respect of ransomware, but in special. And we will also cover the question why open source backups are crucial, especially in this respect. And lastly, I will give an overview of the Bareus open source backup solution. So just to give an overview, what threats do we have when we talk about data loss? We have things like physical damage, of course. We have software failure. We have user failure, someone typing in this and the whole disk is lost, of course. And then there is malware. The screens that users get shown when they are hit by ransomware. Ransomware, I think most of us know what it is, but I'll just explain in a few words. That is, if you get some software on your computer that you definitely don't want there, but this kind of software will encrypt all your data, and then you have to buy a key to decrypt it again. So in other words, they have taken you hostage because they have your data, they have all your work, and you need to pay them to get a key to free you again. So that's meant here by ransomware. So these are just some threats that may affect you. And of course, there are many, many more, especially the unknown, the unexpected threats that we don't know. So whatever might happen to destroy your data. And it's always good to be prepared just in case you are hit by known or even unknown threats. So just to distinguish a little bit the code, the scope we are talking about, to defend yourself against any kind of attacks, of course, there are firewalls, there are virus scanners, there are intrusion detection and other stuff. And this is, of course, important, but not the scope today. It's scope for other talks. We are talking about resilience and disaster recovery. So just in case that you were hit by some damage, attack, whatever, what are you doing then? Have you a chance to recover, to get back to operational as soon as possible? Or in other words, when we talk about backup, what we are daily doing, what we should daily do is to prepare us against any kind of attacks. And Commander William T. Riker said, our daily routine is the unexpected. So before we start to talk about backup of data, I want to show you another picture, a little side trip. Anybody knows what this picture shows? That's the entry to the so-called Svalbard Global Seed Vault. That's a Norwegian, it's a project funded by the Norwegian government. And it hosts about 860,000 different seeds of species. And so the idea of that is to be prepared in kind of all kind of catastrophes, that after that you can have all the seeds to grow again, food, and to ensure nutrition, and of course diversity. So this picture on the left, on the upper side, shows the inside of that building, someone storing stuff there. And on the downside here, that are several lentil seeds. And there was a first use case of this seed vault in 2015. When we looked to Syria and the civil war in 2010, a local research center, ICADA, they had a large repository of seeds by themselves. They said, okay, we have this war here growing, and let's be safe, let's put at least a portion of it to a Norwegian. And then in 2011, they put a lot of it to Norwegian. And in 2015, they decided to continue their research in another location, I think it's Morocco. And then they retrieved stuff out of Svalbard to grow again their seeds. And then after they got enough to continue their research work, they sent it again back to Norwegian. So this is just a good example of, I called it analog backups, and also to illustrate the importance of the concept of backup your backup. So one backup might not be enough, it's good to have another one. So it's kind of backup replication, what they did here. Okay, but let's go back to the digital work. Sorry?
What's wrong with
step
ladders?
Yes.
That doesn't seem to be the most safest way to.
So I didn't understand.
It's an interesting way to be accessing the ship.
Okay. So, the Norwegian guys, they are outdoor guys. They go climbing and stuff. They don't need ladders or so. Right. Okay. Okay, some general backup guidelines, when we come back to backup data, so our world here, or the digital world. If you do backup in a network, you should definitely copy the data to another server. So we had a boost here several days, and had a lot of people coming in. Oh, I do my backup. I copy my files regularly on a shared network drive or something. So what does this help you if you got attacked by ransomware? It will just encrypt everything it can write to. So it will also encrypt your network share. So that doesn't work. So make backup to dedicated backup servers. And in the best case, they are completely separated from the network by means of other ways to accessing it. So let's let it only access by the network protocol itself. And then I said before, make backups of your backup, so meaning replication. In the best case, to other media and other sites. So what a lot of people do is backup to disk and then to tape. And then you put your tape to some external storage. Then you're on the pretty safe side. Some people said, I must admit, a lot of people ask, oh, can I do backup to the cloud? Yes, you can. But there are two things to consider. First is, if you backup to the cloud, please encrypt in any way. Otherwise, you never know what these cloud people, and cloud is just a synonym for someone else's computer. So you never know what those people are doing with your data, so encrypt it in any way. And the other thing to consider is, if you want to do long-term archiving, consider the costs of the space. I mean, cloud space is very easy. You can just get it, you fire it up, it's in a second, it's there. But then you start paying. And if you leave your data there for, let's say, 10 years, this may sum up to some substantial sum. And if you compare that to even the large investment into a tape library and the cost of tapes, and the tape doesn't consume any energy. Once it's written, you put it into a vault, and it's there just being completely passive, not causing any more costs than for storage. So in you store to tape and then set to cloud when it comes to long-term storage. And then if you find out, oh, okay, my backup space is growing, then it might be a little bit too late. So you should start before you start your backup, you start thinking about how long do I really have to retain the data? Do I really have to be able to restore any file over the last 10 years from every version of every day? So maybe it's okay to, if you go back further than 1 year, that you say, okay, it's enough to have monthly backups or even yearly backups after a while. So if you consider this well, you might need a lot of less space for backup. So but this is just some general guidelines without looking too much to security. When we look especially to the preparation against possible ransomware attacks. So I said before, separate from the rest of your network, only access for backup protocol. If possible, use read-only mediums. So there are special tapes called warm tapes, write once, read many. If you leave those in your library, really nothing can happen unless a bomb falls on it. So, but that's a different threat. And if you are using backup data encryption for your backup data, then there's, of course, some piece of information that deserves special treatment, and that is the encryption key. So first, if you lose it, you can't restore. And if ransomware hits you and encrypts your encryption key, then all your backup data is also lost, and you have no chance. So this is really crucial. Make extra copies of it, put it to CDs, USB sticks somewhat, and to external place. That's really important here. Okay, and then again, if we think about long-term availability, now we are coming to the way why it's crucial to use open source backup software. So from a technical point of view, if you think into the future, let's say in 10 years you want to make a restore of the tapes you have somewhere stored. And then, of course, you need a piece of software to read those data from the tapes. So one important thing is that the way the data is stored on the tape is in a documented and open format. So it doesn't help you if it's proprietary and you don't know what to do with it. Then second, there must, of course, be some kind of software to read the stuff you get in. And the same is true for hardware drivers. So let's say you have your tape and in 10 years you want to read it, and you might find a tape that can read the tape, but then also you need a piece of hardware, a computer, that can connect to the tape, so and with drivers running on it. So these are the technical things to consider. And the other thing is, if it comes to the software you're using, avoid a vendor lock-in. And that's not that rare as it seems to be. There are, well, some easy ways pay per use when you need a restore is something you have to consider. For example, if you're using Amazon Glacier storage, which is kind of economical, but when you have to restore, you just need funding because then it becomes a little bit expensive. So that can be solved with just money. The other thing might not be solvable. So if the software is not existent anymore, it might hit you deeper. And then there are things, limited usage allowances, and some things really happen. So a customer or potential customer called me. They have, with their company, left a bigger group, and those bigger group used to have a framework contract for a backup software vendor. And then the company was sold. This sold process was finished. The sales guy of those proprietary software called him and said, "Hey, you're not part of that group anymore. Our framework contract is not value, does not apply here. You have to pay some $100,000 to continue to run your software. And if you don't do, after the next start of the daemon, software won't run and you can't do the restore." So this is a kind of, no, that's not a kind, that's definitely a vendor lock-in. And I advise to try to avoid such lock-ins. Then there are models outside, kind of subscription models, that have the obligation to delete the software if you decide not to continue pay a subscription fee. And that, of course, means you can't access your data unless you pay. So you're really caught by them. And what happens if a vendor of a software goes out of market? And that is not only applicable to small companies. Even larger companies may decide, we think about Oracle, to discontinue some certain kind of projects or software, and then you're there. So there's nothing that helps you. If it's not open source, you have no chance. So, and that's why open source is crucial for backups. One thing is we have to distinguish between real open source, which means completely open source, and things that call themselves open core or something else. Open core means you have some portion of the software that is open source and something else around it that is not. And this kind of software combines the disadvantages of open source and proprietary source. So it's no reason to use it because it's nothing else than proprietary source or software. If it comes to the question, does it work for me? Do I have a vendor lock-in? Can I use it in the future? So that doesn't help. So really what only helps is real open source. Then you really have no vendor lock-in. Even if the company behind a project may disappear, the code is available and can be adapted. The worst that can happen to you is that you have to find somebody, pay him to develop, continue development. Okay, and the same is true, of course, for the operating system. So we talked about earlier about, are you sure that you can connect your tape drives in the future to a computer? So if you are running on Linux, you have a pretty good choice, a pretty good chance that in the future you will have hardware drivers or someone being able to write your some. So operating system should be open source and the backup software as well. And then you can be sure or not be sure, but then you are very well prepared if you think about data sovereignty. Any questions so far? No. Okay. Yeah, so requirements summary, 100% open source. If you want to be extra prepared in regards of ransomware, keep extra copies of your encryption keys. All that's mandatory anyway. Separate backup data, use backup replication if possible. Use different media types, warm medium if possible. And make sure that you can easily access your backup data if it comes to a disaster. For example, many people ask me, can I run a backup server in a virtual machine? Yes, you can. But imagine what happens in the kind of a disaster. Before you can start your restore process, you have to set up your hypervisor, your VMware Xen or whatever cluster. So it's better to have the backup server as a dedicated machine, and because that will be the first one that you're going to restore and then or recover, and then you can start restoring your data, your configuration, whatever you have. Okay, so now coming to one possible solution, and that is Bareos, the company I work for and the project. So it's both, it's an open source project and a company behind it. Technically, Bareos used to be, or is a fork of the Bacula.org project, which is a little bit more, longer available. The fork was started around 2010, started with a collection of, let's say, patches that didn't make it into Bacula. And in 2012, we decided to make an own project and an own company out of it to implement our own ideas, speed up development, and to sustainably ensure that it stays open source. So we are committed to do 100% open source. We had the first release in 2013, and since then, yearly a new major version. That is some of the things I've said before. So no vendor lock-in, 100% open source. Making a fork is very easy. On GitHub, you just press fork, then you have a fork. But that, of course, doesn't help anybody. So what we did is we really started to look what features are missing, what can we do better by means of code organizing. So we did a lot of cleanup and refactoring. We invented a Python plugin interface to speed up the development of, let's call it agents that are able to back up special environments like VMware, like databases, like other applications. We have a growing open source community, an open storage format. And one thing is we have special tools to access the tapes. So even if you have lost your Bareo server, but you still got your tapes, there are simple command line tools which eases the disaster recovery, or at least the first steps out of it, to get your really servers back running. I've got like 10 minutes left. So. I can show a little bit the architecture overview. So what Bareos usually does is it can backup all your machines and your network. So if you look to the left column here, that is what you can backup. So starting with Linux, Unix, Windows, Mac clients, and client could be a desktop or a server, doesn't matter. We just install our agent there, Linux daemon running and providing interfacing the Bareos server, which is centrally configured. And he connects secured by a shared secret. And with the next version, we will also automatically start encryption with these shared secrets, which you can already do by now. But by now, you have to do a lot of manual work to get it running encrypted. With the next version, it will be starting automatically, unless you decide not to use it. But normally, people will use encryption. So then everything is centrally configured here. It has a database and configuration files, and there's a schedule which says what to backup from which computer at what time to what storage. And the storage is here on the left side. This could be just a simple file space on the backup server. It can be tapes or tape changes. And we support several kind of cloud storages. So the first was Gluster and Ceph. And meanwhile, we can also write to S3 compatible interfaces. And that makes people think about funny things. We have a national archive from a European country. They have digitized all their material that they've collected over the centuries, and they have that all stored on a Gluster FS. And they said, okay, we want to have a backup of all this data, but using a different technology. So they decided to make a backup from the Gluster FS on a Ceph FS storage. So that can be done. You can also write it from a Gluster storage on tape, for example. So everything is possible there. Okay, this is just to repeat for someone reading the slides in the future. Some of the new features we've developed over the years, one is hardware encryption. So modern tape drives support a hardware subscription. You can just upload a key to the hardware drive, and that's pretty fast. And Bareos manages all that. We support, for example, client support, quota support, and bandwidth limitation. So if you don't have a dedicated network backup, for example, and you have to run your backups over daytime, you maybe want to limit the bandwidth it can have to let other people continue to work. We support NDMP that is used with big storages, for example, from NetApp. We can do replication to other backup sites. We have several cloud interfaces. We have a Python plugin interface, which makes it quite easy to develop plugins. We have a nice multilingual and multi-tenant web UI. So when it comes to Restore, you have a web browser. Maybe I can show you for a minute. It's not there, sorry. You have a file browser where you just can select Restore all the files, or just one, or maybe a subdirectory. And it has an API, a JSON RPC, so you can integrate it in your existing environment and automate, for example, if you get new clients on your network, you can automatically create with this API the backup jobs for these clients. Or you can also start restore jobs using the API. So let's say if you have another already some kind of management software or web UI for your users, you could integrate the restore process, for example. Okay, so the source code is always on GitHub, and we use the Open Build Server to build installation packages and repositories for almost all major Linux distributions. For macOS, we also use the Open Build Server to make Windows installer packages, and we have packages for Solaris, AIX, and so on. And if you need something else, just ask us, and we may be able to build packages. FreeBSD is missing on that list. Sorry, that's pretty new. Also supported. Okay, this is the picture of the web UI browser. So on the left, you have the clients to choose from. Here you can choose where to restore. So for example, if you've completely lost a machine, then you can restore the data to just another machine. And you can select where to restore. So in the default case, it will restore to some place below the temp directory. But you can also just write a slash here, and then it will go to the origin location of the file. Okay, we are rated on OpenHub, which is a platform that analyzes open source projects. It just scans GitHub and makes analyses over how many commits there are, how long is the contribution phase, and so on. And there we are rated in the top 2% of all projects on GitHub. And then there's in France, there is an intergovernmental working group on open source, and they have set up a list with open source software they recommend to use for public administration in France. And there we are listed as, I think there are two backup solutions listed, and one is Bareos on that list. Unfortunately, this line ends at the end of 2015, because then we decided to use Miros for download. But until then, we had about every half a year, doubling the number of accesses to download Bareos.org, where the packages are. And at the end of 2015, it was something about 122 unique visitors on download.bareos.org. Well, this, of course, also includes like Debian clients looking if there are updates. So we don't know the exact number, but we see that it's until that time, it doubled almost every half a year. Some of customers using us, so one case study, which you can also find on the web, is the Bavarian State Archives, and we have a lot of universities, the Max Planck Gesellschaft, Max Planck Society in Germany, and from all kind of industries. So backup is something that everybody needs, and it scales from very low or very small implementations up to really large ones. So you can use it in your home office, but you can also use it in large organizations, such as in public archive. Okay, we offer services with our global partner network, which has room for improvement. That's one of the reasons why we are here. We are looking for open source minded service companies, integrators that are interested to deliver services around Bareos, other open source projects to their customers. So if you're interested, just send me an email. Here are all the contacts, Git, our bug tracker, my email address, and so on. And here, and there's one thing. There's a blog story about the ransomware and Bareos that I've written some years ago. There's a link, you can read it for some more details. Then we have some picture credits. And last, if you find, wow, backup is a cool subject, I want to learn more, we have an annual conference in Cologne. September is a pretty good time to come to Cologne, especially 26th this year, then it's the 10th anniversary. Just feel free and grab your early bird ticket. Sorry for the advertising here. Okay, any questions? Sorry?
What happens if you lose the catalogs?
If we lose what?
Catalogs.
The catalogs, the database. That's bad, unless you have a copy. So by default, if you install Bareos, it makes every day Every day, is right? Yeah, every day, a backup of the catalog itself. If you want to have, you can also have an extra copy sent to you by email or copy to other places. But usually that will be the first task. If you lost everything, but you've got your tapes, you can use these command line tools to find the backup of the catalog on the tape or other backup media.
So there's a catalog on the tape?
Yes, there's a catalog on the tape. And then second, if you can't restore your catalog, there are tools that can kind of restore the catalog from the media. So, but that of course will involve some work, because then you have to put every media, if it's a tape, into the drive, scan it, but then it will these tools will fill a new catalog again with the information it finds on the backup media. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Sorry.